portion of the chair and also a portion of the front door to the left side of the chair.
149.
149 is depicting the staining area on, as you're sitting in the chair, right arm interior.
150.
150 is a photograph depicting the left arm, bird's eye view of the chair as well.
151.
151 is a photograph depicting the transfer stains consistent with the running hand.
One.
171 is after the cut.
172.
172 is the right arm of the chair as you're sitting in the chair. Again, they took that portion in as evidence as well. So that's an overall view of the cut.
173.
A more close-up of that same cut to the right arm of the chair. And then once the fabric is removed from the right arm, an additional bone graft.
And just for the record, your last comment, was that directed at 174?
That's correct.
Thank you. And I'm sorry, 175?
175 is once the fabric is removed from the right arm of the chair. This is the technician holding it.
176?
176 is a photograph depicting an isolated stain that's on a wall near the kitchen area.
To your knowledge, was this stain ever tested?
No, it was not.
177?
That is a close-up photograph of that isolated stain.
So we have a stain in the kitchen area, is that fair?
That's correct.
Okay, and that stain was never analyzed?
No, it was not.
Okay. 178 is labeled Blue Star examination of stain. Can you tell the jury, what is Blue Star?
Blue Star is a chemical that reacts in the presence of blood. Oftentimes, the crime scene, the blood is cleaned up by the perpetrator. So, a lot of times, by spraying the area with Blue Star forensics, you can bring back the blood patterns, which is what they try to do in this particular case. So, Blue Star is a chemical that is a chemiluminescence. It gives you a blue light color in the presence of blood. So, the old technology used to be called luminol, but now it is called Blue Star forensics.
So, 179, what are we looking at here?
179 is the floor of the kitchen area. And you can see the trash cans in the background. And then they spray the floor.
We're going to go 120. Okay.
They sprayed the floor and it was negative for any reaction from the Blue Star.
181?
181 is a photograph depicting the kitchen sink prior to the spraying of Blue Star.
And 182?
This will be the reaction in the kitchen sink.
Nothing. 184. Sorry. Let's skip to 184. Can we make out what's in 184?
Again, it's just a negative result.
And 185?
185 would be the kitchen sink faucet and knobs. And
sorry, 186?
This would be the reaction with the Blue Star. Okay. Now, Blue Star also reacts with things other than blood. So when you have a reaction like this, if you don't come back with a chemical called phenylalanine or another presumptive test, it could be a false positive. Blue Star reacts with things like detergent, so any cleaning agent that may be on that faucet, such as soap or whatever. If you don't take a sample, if you don't come back with another presumptive test, that could be a false positive. And as far as I know, they didn't do any additional testing.
187?
187 is a chemical reacting with the Blue Star.
And
188 is another area that's sprayed with the Blue Star.
How would you describe the area?
This area, there's cooler. This would be the living room adjacent to where the body was located. And you can see the blue cooler. You can see a chair. It appears that maybe the scene had been, some things had been moved around by the time this is taken. But this is the area where the body was positioned on the floor in the living room.
189?
189 is a more close-up of that area. And then again, this is chemiluminescence. And also, we have to go back to possibly this was a false positive because you can see how small the little specks are. If the carpet had ever been shampooed or some type of shampoo product for carpet, you could be getting a false positive. So, as far as I know, they didn't go back with phenylalanine and they didn't go back with Doody. So this could be false positives.
191?
191 is a photograph depicting the wall behind the chair, and you can see the door adjacent to. In this picture, the police have already done the fingerprint processing, and they're getting ready to spray hour before, and then after the application, the would start.
1-9-4, you're referring to 1-9-6?
1-9-6, yes. There's one positive blue reaction.
1-9-7?
1-9-7 is a photograph of the clear glass table.
1-9-8?
And then after they apply the blue star, again, on the glass top table, you can see evidence of wiping.
Now, 199 is a little deceiving clothing examination. What's the forensic significance of examining deceiving clothing?
Okay. A lot of times on the deceiving clothing, you may find blood patterns, you may find transfer patterns. So it could be probative evidence for reconstruction. So if you, and they did take photographs of those clothes for examination.
200?
Photograph 200 is a photograph obviously taken in the laboratory by the police, and you can see blood patterns on the clothing. We've already discussed the fact that there are transfer stains and also 90-degree drops on the upper thigh area of the blue jeans. And again, these are the deceiving clothes.
And 201?
201 is showing, this is the front side of the blue jeans. This is actually showing some transfer stains on the upper left hand.
202
is photographs depicting some droplets that are 90 degree on the top region area of the sequence. This would be the left one.
203?
203 would be a more close-up photograph of the front side of the deceased jeans, and this would be the droplets of blood on the right side, right upper thigh.
204?
This is a more close-up picture of that blood droplet that appears to be 89 degrees. Very subtle.
Sorry, 205?
205 is the second staining on that same right leg on the thigh.
206?
And 206 would be a close-up photograph of those stains to the right upper thigh of the blue jeans of the deceased.
207?
207 would be the back side of the blue jeans, and there's very little blood on the back side of that.
208?
208 would be a more close-up picture of the back of the left leg.
209?
209 would be a photograph of the shirt that the deceased was wearing with scale.
Sorry, 210?
210 would be showing the neck region area that the deceased front of the shirt.
And finally, 211.
211 would be showing some impact spatter that is on the front of the shirt.
Now, in reviewing all of those photographs and all of the evidence,
I'm going to ask you two sets of questions. The first set of questions is, were there any limitations in your analysis? In other words, were there things that law enforcement could have done that would have better aided your analysis of the case? And let me ask a more pointed question. With respect to the golf club, is there anything that law enforcement could have done or that you would have liked to have seen done that would have assisted in your analysis of the evidence of the golf club?
I would have liked to have seen the golf club sent for DNA analysis.
And why would that have mattered to you?
Because if someone was possibly corrupt with the golf club, there could be, number one, epithelial cells from that person, or there could be blood or even hair on that golf club. And so as far as I know, that was never done.
And what about with respect to the clothing of the victim and or the clothing of Mr. Sipa?
Again, whose blood is where on the clothing would be important, especially the deceased's clothing. The droplets that are 90 degrees, I would like to know whose blood that is. That's important, because oftentimes the subject will bleed onto the deceased's clothing, and that can give you a little bit of information for reconstruction.
What about the sampling spatter that's on the chair?
None of that was conducted.
When you say none of that, what do you mean?
There was no sampling. It's referred to as road mapping. So when you have a bloody scene such as this, you should basically collect a lot of samples, and like a pattern A, like
And what about the documentation of the blood stain in this case?
Okay, they put scales in the photographs, but you do, they did overall scaling, how far up and how over or over, but you need to take detailed photographs with metric scales, overall, and it's referred to as it's been around since 1997, so it's a technique that's supposed to be utilized in a bloody scene such as this, and there was no real matching techniques that were used. So it's overall photographs, metric scales in place, and where the sampling was collected, so you'll know whose blood is where. In this particular scene, we have two people that were bleeding, so whose blood is where? We don't have that answer.
Now, in your entire review of the case, did you come to an opinion regarding an event reconstruction? In other words, a reconstruction generally of the events based off the forensic evidence of the case?
Yes.
Okay, I want you to start at the beginning. You need to refer to your report on page 8. Please feel free to do so. But starting with the beginning, what conclusions did you come to?
Yeah. Opinion number one, the forensic evidence of a physical altercation with abrasions and contusions to both of the individuals involved. So could have taken place prior to the fatal attack. Okay, so that could have been, there could have been a fistfight or something of that nature. Someone could have been punched in the nose. There appears to be bruising. face in the center of the man's eyes, so it appears to be a lot of compression in. Both have injuries to their hands, so there could have been a physical altercation.
Can you exclude that there was a physical altercation prior to what you described as the bloodletting events? Can you exclude that in your analysis?
No, I cannot.
Okay. Moving on, what is your next conclusion regarding the event reconstruction?
When you look at a scene like this, you want to see if there's blood anywhere other than the primary area. And the primary area of this crime scene is that chair, the area of the chair, the wall behind the chair. All the blood is surrounding that chair, okay? So there is only one isolated stain that's in one wall adjacent to the kitchen. So that could be a cast off, we don't know. We don't even know whose blood that is, okay? Because there's no additional blood anywhere else, there could have been an altercation. It leads to the area of the chair. When you look at the chair, nobody sits in a chair with a backpack in the seat. I mean, that's not going to be a natural event. So either somebody got thrown into the chair, or that there was an altercation, and then somebody's there at the area of the chair.
Okay, moving on. What is your next conclusion with respect to the event of construction?
Okay, when you have possibly two weapons in a scene, this is always a consideration. What happened? Why two weapons? Normally, one weapon fails, so then you have to go to the second one. Okay? In this particular case, why does it fail? That lamp is broken. You see what I'm saying? So when the lamp fails, what else is there? There's knives everywhere. Okay. So, in my opinion, based upon the reconstruction of the knife is the second.
Let me stop you there, because there's been three weapons that we've discussed: the knife, the lamp, and the golf club. Okay, let me isolate the golf club for a second. In your examination, do you have an opinion as to what involvement, if any, the golf club played in this incident?
Number one, when you consider there's no blood on the golf club,
okay,
we don't know when the golf club was broken. That could have been the day before, the month before, the year before. We don't know when that happened. A broken golf club is a broken golf club, unless there's some forensic findings on that golf club that tells you this was part of the event. We don't know that, so that's an unknown factor. So my primary weapons, based upon the blood evidence, the injuries to the individual, would be the lamp.
Is there anything about the nature of the injuries that lends you to believe it was the lamp as well?
The lamp, when you look, I pointed out the circular
So lamp first, then go, what's the next step in your event construction?
Okay. So if your weapon fails, what do you do next? You grab anything that's around. And so the knife was there, obviously. The knife was used. And we have evidence of that because we got these punctate abrasions on the chest. There's also some surrounding the body. So if you measure the prongs, it's consistent with that knife.
So let me stop with the knife. In your forensic analysis, can you come to any conclusion regarding the location of the knife, or who had it in their possession, or at what time, anything like that?
No, I cannot.
Okay, explain to the jury why you can't.
It's a movable object. It's a movable object. And without, bloody fingerprints or something of that nature, forensic-wise, there's no evidence.
Okay, and please go for it. Do you have any further conclusions with respect to the events?
Of course, at the end of the events, evidence of cleanup. That's pretty obvious in the reconstruction. Now, we've got the trash cans, we've got the body wrapped up. It's been moved out of the chair onto the floor. So the scene has somewhat been staged at all.
Do you have any other findings or conclusions with respect to your crime scene analysis that the jury should have?
The impact patterns surrounding the chair, everything is consistent with the decedent being in a seated position. What further helps that is the 90-degree drops on the upper thighs of his blue jeans that is coming from the right down. Okay? There's no evidence of the person standing up during any of this. There's no blood on the lower portion of the blue jeans. There's nothing on the back side of the blue jeans. Everything is consistent with being in a seated position in that chair when all these forceful impacts come.
And is there any forensic, in your forensic analysis, is there an indication as to how the individual ended up in the chair?
No, there is not. So again, there could have been a physical altercation.